Hello, welcome to week two. We're gonna start really our unit by talking about something that may seem counterintuitive, which is in a course that is mostly about political communication, civil society, at these transnational actors at networks, we're gonna be talking about Hollywood. But the idea is not that we'll be talking specifically about Hollywood film and the film industry, is that Hollywood will be the framework, in this case, a sort of theoretical framework to talk about a very important type of transnational actor at network that has to do with the transmission, the communication, and the adoption of ideas, right? So let me then start by justifying really why film is important. And in this case, not so much film, but Hollywood film. And if you think about it, there is on one level, Hollywood is ever present, even when it's not present, because Hollywood is taken as the norm. If you think about the film industry, you think about Hollywood, and then there is different national cultures. You have Australian cinema, and then you have cinema, which is Hollywood, right? So Australian cinema, different other national cinemas anywhere in the world, really see themselves against that Hollywood mountain that they need to climb, right? And this is a financial reality of film. But at the same time, we need to go beyond that, and we need to think how Hollywood, in the languages they speak, they are embedded in political conversations that are by nature global. And that these political conversations that are by nature global, and then I will talk specifically just in a moment about that, they are against this national, they're in conversation, whether directly or indirectly, with these national films. And their vision of what's to be culturally represented, okay? And this is now so abstract, but when we start getting into the nitty-gritty, and I'll give you some examples, hopefully it becomes more evident, and hopefully it becomes more intuitive why I'm choosing film and Hollywood film to talk about different type of transnational politics, and especially why culture here is important, right? As Beasley and Brooke have stated in one of the assigned articles, they think about film and Hollywood films and all the films that come out of Hollywood as part of a cultural and political landscape that both construct and reflect social life. And here what's important is that construct and reflect social life. And when we think about social life, I'm not exaggerating in terms of when we think about individual leaders, heroes, what comes to mind is the Hollywood superhero. And the Hollywood superhero, it is directly and indirectly related to that political leader, that self-reliant individual upon whom humanity's destiny relies, right? And if we think about heroic motifs in any type of leader, whether it's an activist or a politician or, economic leaders, we think about that individualistic trope that Hollywood film reflects, because it's a reflection of American social life, but it also constructs, right? But we can also think about romantic comedies and our ideas of love and how Hollywood romantic comedies, which are global, how they are reflecting an idea of love, but at the same time, they construct an idea of love. And this idea of love and this construction and reflection, they go hand in hand, because what is reflected has been previously constructed by different hegemonic cultures. And I will get into the idea of hegemonic culture in a couple of slides. But think about what the and by now, think about hegemonic as dominant, right? And this idea of love, for instance, romantic comedy, it's always heterosexual, was most, especially until very recently, it's always been heterosexual. It's upper middle class type of love. It's family oriented. It's the idea of, at the end, having a family or being framed within the family. It is monogamous. It is romantic in the sense of romantic love, right? And there is, I can go on with all these different tropes, right? But in the end, what these Hollywood films are doing, which in the end, I'll use Hollywood film as a shorthand for popular film. What they're doing, they're speaking in the language of values, and a language of values that are taken as universal, even though they're very specific to American culture. And these values are, in the end, the base of all type of politics. From these values, politics are created, right? And if these values go global, and Hollywood certainly is global, then you can have the justification. In this case, I justify the importance of film, at least as a framework to understand this a type of transnational politics that are transmitted in a not so straightforward way. Even though, like we will see in a moment, sometimes it could be very overt, this type of politics, right? So I look at popular movies, Hollywood films, really, as political technologies. And let me explain a little bit about this, right? Because if you think about Hollywood as an industry that is global, that has importance in speaking the language of universal values, and I'm using universal here within inverted commas, right? Because obviously values are never universals, but values are always contingent to a culture, to a historical moment, even to ideologies, right? But Hollywood makes this, speaks in the language of values that are universal, and then it creating this industry creates a system of signs that communicates those values. And these values are American values, right? And then this system of signs is that technology. And this technology is political. Hence, Hollywood film are these political technologies that transmit directly or indirectly a series of values that pass as universal, but in reality are contingent to American society and American ideology, right? So I'll give you two examples. One is very direct and one is indirect, right? War Hollywood films, right? They mostly align with US foreign policy. And there is a plethora of war movies coming up from Hollywood that not only relied on, for instance, clearance by the Pentagon to use tanks or helicopters or soldiers' attire. That's on a small scale level, but they are sometimes directly funded by the Pentagon. And this not only happens in the US, this happens across the board. The thing is that the only war films that can go global are Hollywood war films, right? So that is very common. And if you think any movie around the war against terror, since the early 2000s, it's almost in your face, right? Now, indirectly, which is to me, it's one of the most interesting ones, then we have other political mythologies, right? And we can have all sort of like popular films in which the idea of the US being an exceptional country, an exceptional free country, is taken for granted, where individualism is basically rampant, or is the norm, right? The idea of the American dream, this rag to riches story, meritocracy, everyone who is at the top deserves to be at the top. If you just think about any Hollywood film in the past, you know, year, there is, in all of them, there is at least one of these major political mythologies, And you can, and it's not too much, it's very much on the surface, but it's never explicit in the film. It's always in the background. And that's what's interesting. And the difference between war Hollywood films and other type of popular films is that while in war Hollywood films, it's very much the purpose of the film, and it's aligned and it's framed within that foreign policy agenda, for instance, or let's say government's national agenda. The rest of the film, in like superhero films, for instance, Captain America, the Avengers, have that idea, but it's embedded in the plot and it's hidden from sight. Although it's not too hard to surmise once we think, you know, more than 2 minutes about it, right? So that's why I'm talking about Hollywood films as political technology, because we can think about them as visual artifacts that have the ability to penetrate the global market very effectively and reproduce or even produce ideas of what is normal and what is not normal. And that is the key to understand film as politics, and in this case, film as a in this case, the Hollywood industry, film industry as a political technology, as a visual artifact that penetrates the global market, and not just sells you a product, but establishes what's normal and what's not normal, because other national film industries will react either directly or indirectly to that normality or abnormality, react to that idea of what the Hollywood standard is setting, right? So in this sense, what we have in here is the intersection of power relationships. And this is precisely, in a nutshell, the power to set what's normal and what's not normal, the power to set a normative agenda, right? That intersection of power relationship, what's normal, what's not normal, with popular culture. And this is what you can consider, what we can be termed as Hollywood's cultural politics. And it's really important because it's that example of how transnational politics are transmitted through cultural politics, through transnational cultural politics, and how these type of power relationships are effective precisely because they are not overt. They work indirectly, right, through the back door, which it doesn't mean that they're not hard to surmise, they're not hard to see through, yeah, but their effectiveness most of the time lies precisely because we cannot recognize it as something that is explicit political. Because we have this divide between politics and culture, right? This artificial divide between politics and culture. So a really fun example of what I'm talking about and the importance of this language of universal values, that are mostly indirect, can be seen in many major films, but I think Titanic, especially Slavoj Žižek, which is a philosopher that studies culture, the intersection of culture and politics, from a psychoanalytic angle. But in this case, he's not getting into that. What's interesting here is something Žižek is looking at here is something that really passed unnoticed when you watch Titanic, and I'm gonna play this clip and let you hear him, and then I'll say some words after that.
What am I doing here in the middle of the ocean, alone in a boat, surrounded by frozen corpses? I'm in a scene from James Cameron's Titanic.
Jack.
Which is the supreme case of ideology in recent Hollywood. Why? Because of the imminent tension to the story of the film.
I don't know the steps.
Neither do I. Just go with it. Don't think.
We have at least three levels. First, there is what people ironically refer to as James Cameron's Hollywood Marxism. This ridiculous, fake sympathy with lower classes. Up there, first-class passengers, they are mostly all evil, egotistic, cowardly.
You know I don't like that, Rose.
Embodied in Kate Winslet's fiancé, played by Billy Zane.
She knows.
This whole narrative is sustained by a much more reactionary myth.
Those guys' faces.
We should ask, what role does the iceberg hitting the ship play in the development of the love story?
When the ship docks, I'm getting off with you.
This is crazy.
I know.
My claim is here a slightly cynical one. This would have been the true catastrophe. We can imagine how, maybe after 2-3 weeks of intense sex in New York, the love affair would somehow fade away.
Right, so the love affair will fade away precisely because of the class divide, because it will be unsustainable. In the set of American values that in which Hollywood is embedded, and this is very much an unconscious operation. It's not meant to be explicit, and you can see how that inter-class marriage is abnormal. It doesn't happen, not only because it barely happens in Hollywood, and it only happened from a top-down position in which someone from the lower classes is brought up to the upper classes. Think of Pretty Woman, Richard Gere's Pretty Woman, right? You bring someone up to the upper level, it's never in the murky waters of the class divide. Not only because of that, not only because it's never really actualized in Hollywood films, it is because in the caricature of both the lower classes and the upper classes, in that caricature, that class divide is normalized as something, as a given, as an atmospheric phenomenon, at something that it's always there, that it's very easy to delineate, that you can see that representation of class as so unnuanced, and it doesn't strike you as abnormal. It strikes you as that's the norm. Rich people are evil, poor people are nice. And that is not about being true or untrue. That is about what it triggers in the audience. And what it triggers in the audience is, I understand that. They're not strange from that concept. And in that not being strange, what you're doing ironically is precisely establishing the class divide as something completely normal, right? And not only that, that class divide as a given is unbridgeable, because when it's bridged, in the only occasion that it's bridged or is about to be bridged, it's always exceptional. And I would even add that it's not always exceptional, it's always the lower class going up to the upper class, right? And in Titanic, in this case, the iceberg, and that's why Zizek talks about the iceberg is precisely what prevents the relationship, the inter-class relationship, to be fulfilled. And what he's saying rather cynically is that that's probably the best part of the movie, because if it was actually fulfilled, it wouldn't work. it wouldn't work. Yeah. So as you can see now, Hollywood is talking about that that hidden, it's not, I really, when I say hidden, what I really mean is not in your face, in the sense that politics and political agendas are very much explicit. They have to be explicit. What cultural politics, and this is what I say, what I really mean when I'm saying hidden and the language of universal values that is somehow hidden, is hidden in relation to politics. And politics are by nature in the open. And they are pragmatic. They are about creating a set of policies. Cultural politics are the opposite, are in the opposite side of the explicit. And that's why, for instance, in Titanic, we speak that language of the class divide as unbridgeable, as taken for granted. And that's why I like to look at Hollywood film as a form of soft power, and how film, as we will see later on with Chinese film, are different ways of creating soft power, of creating frameworks for what of values that are acceptable or unacceptable, right? And this idea of soft power, it's a term that was created, first espoused by Joseph Nice, right? And really what he is getting at, what Joseph Nice getting at, is what I was just saying just a moment before, is that we think about power, we think about foreign policy, and we think about state power, and that's completely explicit, but there is, and that's hard power, right? But we need to think also about this, the term of soft power, and then a quote here, to describe the modes of advancing national security, including foreign aid and diplomacy, by means that are indirect, that encourage other countries and the peoples to admire, emulate, support, and acquiesce to such advancement. Soft power is the power to win hearts and minds as well as wars, right? This idea of admiring, emulating, supporting, because obviously, we have to support U.S. foreign policy, because otherwise, what would we do? What would we cannot just be against U.S. foreign policy. And how do you find that acceptable? Precisely through the language of universal values, because the U.S. stands for freedom, the U.S. stands for democracy, the U.S. stands for whatever individual liberties, the U.S. stand for meritocracy, right? And these things, if you put them out in the open, they sometimes are crass, but when they're simply taken for granted, you don't even have to question them. You just simply accept them as part of the political background. And Hollywood film is the vessel through which these universal values, and remember, I'm talking about universal values here with inverted commas, are transmitted, right? And this is the form, and this is how soft power is created. So soft power can be indirect and can be direct or explicit, right? And I'm not, a time of soft power that it's indirect is class divide in that way, accepting class divides. Capitalism is about different hierarchies, and that creates different classes, and different classes belong to different hierarchies according to their merits, right? That could be an argument for capitalism that. And it could be an argument for a type of soft power that is very much implicit, that that is not out in the open, right? Now, that type of, whether you agree or disagree with that, with that interpretation, of Titanic and the class divide and meritocracy and capitalism. I think that's besides the point. Because what it's clear is that there is this language that is accepted that sometimes is effective in creating an acceptance of whatever value. But the important part is that that language is there. And that language is aimed at creating soft power. And that soft power could be or could not be created, but that's the aim of Hollywood. And you can see that in Hollywood's war movies. And I think Black Hawk Down is that type of uses that type of language in which is clearly aimed at acquiring a type of soft power that revolves around U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East, and in this case, in Africa. But you know, it's basically in Black Hawk Down, which is set in Somalia. It's just another symbol of the other. Of the other that can be seen in the Middle East, in this case, in the 2000, you know, was the first invasion of Iraq and then later Afghanistan and then Iraq again, right? So this is the early 2000s. So let's watch a trailer of Black Hawk Down, and then I think everybody can see how this idea, this construction of universal values through Hollywood film and the pushing of an agenda, it's very out in the open. It's much more overt than, let's say, my interpretation of Titanic and the class divide and this type of language of capitalism, for instance. Yeah, this is much more in the open because it really aligns with the U.S. foreign policy, and that's why I think this is more important, because it's a much more effective example.
You shouldn't have come here. This is our war, not yours.
300,000 dead and counting. That's not a war, Mr. Ito. It's genocide.
These people, they have no food. We can either help, or we can sit back and watch a country destroy itself on CNN.
Rangers, Deltas, today we go.
Name?
Blackburn.
Date of birth?
2/27/75.
I was trained to fight. You trained to fight, Sergeant?
I was trained to make a difference.
So guess what? You're going out today.
What?
It's what you wanted, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah.
Just remember when everybody else is shooting the same direction. You ever shot at anybody before?
No, Sergeant.
Me neither.
Once that first bullet goes past your head, politics go right out the window.
Hey, baby, it's me. You there? Pick up if you're there.
I love you, baby.
RPG! Hold on! 6-4 is going down!
Black Hawk Down. Black Hawk Down.
My men are surrounded by thousands of Somali militia. I need help now.
Where's the rescue squad?
We're in.
I can't do it.
It's what you do right now that makes a difference.
People ask me, why do you do it, man? They want to understand it's about the men next to you.
Don't let that man crawl. Somebody help that man.
That's all it is.
No one gets left behind, you know that.
Nobody asks to be a hero. It just sometimes turns out that way.
Right. Nobody asks to be a hero. It has to be a hero. Sometimes turns out that way, right? The hero model here. But also, at some point, there is another phrase. I'm not I was trained with us. I'm trained to make a difference, right? Soldiers make a difference. Soldiers liberate countries. Soldiers liberate others. And then you can see the American soldier and these authorized Somalians who are either victims or villains. There's no in between, right? Completely flat psychologically, right? But that is not... that's a byproduct of the film, because the film's main agenda is to entertain people. And here's the kicker, right? The film's agenda is to entertain people, but they entertain people with the language of US foreign policy. And that's where soft power can be enacted effectively, because you entertain through the language of war as thought by US foreign policy. And that second part flies under the radar, because you want to be just, as an audience, just entertained. In the same way that when you were watching Titanic, you just want to be entertained by a love story. The language used in that love story is the language, arguably, of capitalism. Right? A stratified class hierarchies, you rise up to another class through merit. And in this case, the merit of being a lovable, nice person, better than those evil upper classes, right? And it's also exceptional, right? It's an exceptional thing. In this case, the language of US foreign policy is we invade other countries, kill other people because we have to, because we need to liberate them, because we want to expand and give American democracy and freedom to everybody, right? No questions about it. And you do that effectively through entertainment, through Hollywood film, right? And that's how you construct hegemony. And here is the most important, to me, it's the most important mechanism, because soft power assumes a straightforward relationship between this government national agenda and all these Hollywood films, especially war films, superhero films. So think about Captain America is another one. Or Rocky, if you watch Sylvester Stallone's Rocky in the 80s. It's very straightforward in the type of soft power that is assumed. You know, basically the framework in Rocky is the framework of the Cold War. It's the American democracy, freedom against Soviet communist tyranny and evil, right? So soft power is much more straightforward, which another mechanism that works alongside soft power, right, is hegemony. And the thing with hegemony and is not only that it's less straightforward, but it's much more effective, because the problem that we may have with looking, with using soft power to analyze transnational political and cultural relations is that sometimes we cannot state that when audiences like Hollywood war films, they are actually aligning with US foreign policy. You may watch and be entertained and love a war film like Black Hawk Down or like Zero Dark 30, all these other war movies, or Rambo, and you might not necessarily actively align with US foreign policy, right? But what may be happening in there, and this is how hegemony is useful, is not so much that audiences are aligning or against US foreign policy by, for instance, not wanting to watch this type of movies. What may be happening in there, it would be a product of what Antonio Gramsci termed as hegemony, in the early 20th century. And it's a much more subtle mechanism by which these audiences may be simply buying the language of subjugation to that ruling ideology. And subjugation here doesn't mean to be subjugated by an oppressive ruling ideology. It simply means that it's a top-down language. It's a language that comes from the top, from a ruler's idea, and they're accepted by the bottom. And in that way, in that acceptation, that mechanism of acceptation, that is subjugation. And it's a political science term, right? It's not your colloquial subjugation. Subjugation is simply the accepting of the consensus of ruling ideology. How ruling ideology create consensus. And it doesn't do it through coercion. Most effectively, it does it through hegemony, right? This is our cultural processes, and that's why I think Hollywood film is such an important way to talk about hegemony. Because hegemony is done through different cultural mechanisms, in this case, let's say Hollywood film, by which this ruler's ideology of what is and what is not acceptable, let's see, it's acceptable to invade a foreign country in the name of democracy. It is acceptable to kill terrorists without being taken to a judge before, without due process, in the name of the war on terror. Think about that. And think about how we've accepted, for instance, that governments have not only the power, but the responsibility to kill a suspected terrorist on site in the name of protecting democracy, the people, right? You wouldn't do that in any other realm of life, really. You would have to take someone to in front of a judge and try that person and sentence that person. And in many countries, sentencing that person to death will be considered immoral. But let's say we, for argument's sake, that we don't think it's immoral and that we accept the death penalty. But you have to have this due process before you can kill someone. Even, you know, the most egregious type of criminal, you think about the most egregious type of criminal, someone that may, not to get gruesome, you know, but let's think, you know, someone who's killing children. We wouldn't kill that person as a preventive measure if we think we suspect that that person may be killing children, right? In civil society, we take it to trial. Now, that murky line, that line gets murky when it comes to foreign policy, right? And we accept that precisely because there is a consensus that US foreign policy kills terrorists in the name of global freedom. And that is basically accepted. And that is reflected and constructed, both reflected and constructed through Hollywood war films, right? But there are other type of hegemonic consensus that we basically take for granted, that we do not really explore in detail because we simply accept the framework. And there is this one that that you can see in many films, and in which is the substance of all type of political ideas. That has to do with this idea that humanity, if we are left to our own devices, will in the end be selfish, that we are by nature selfish, right? Or mostly selfish. And that's why we need rulers. That's why we need government to make sure that our selfish instincts don't get in the way of our collective lives. And in that way, leaders are justified, for instance. We need leaders to create any type of collective actions. And these hegemonic ideas are transmitted through culture, and in this case, more effectively through popular films. And when I say films, I'm also actually here referring to television and television series. And they create a consensus in this much more indirect way. And therefore, certain national agendas can be pushed much more easily within that framework. And that's why I think hegemonic processes allow us to see a soft power agenda much more easily, right? It's a, it, and these are just means of interpretation, mechanism of interpretations, a soft power agenda, yeah. And this hidden hegemonic idea that you can see in many films follows this Hobbesian model that it's very common in popular culture. And this idea that, like I said, you know, we are selfish in nature, and it follows Thomas Hobbes, right? And I think The Walking Dead is that very good example of how even after the world has ended, you need to be careful with human beings, because human beings are more dangerous than zombies, right? Zombies in The Walking Dead are always in the background. It's a menace that sometimes is not seen in hours of a season. You can spend hours watching The Walking Dead and maybe you see one or two zombies. The real danger in The Walking Dead is other human beings. And that is a hegemonic consensus. And that is how you justify governments, for instance. And I'm not saying, again, remember that I'm not advocating implicitly for the opposite. I'm not advocating for getting rid of governments. What I'm saying is I'm trying to point out a mechanism by which governments are accepted, regardless if you think governments are good or bad. Modern governments are accepted, and top-down politics are accepted because there is this cultural soup by which we understand that we are inherently selfish and that we need guardians. And this acceptance is not out in the open all the time. This acceptance is a consensus that becomes hegemonic indirectly through popular culture. And film is that symptom. Popular film is that symptom of how that consensus is being accepted. And you can see this is trailer for season 8. And in the trailer for season 8, which is, I'm not going to summarize The Walking Dead, but it's basically at some point when all these characters in The Walking Dead have achieved some type of harmony. They create this city that is called Alexandria. You know, think about Alexandria, Egypt in Alexandria. What happened to Alexandria? The Alexandria Library, if you go just Wikipedia data and you'll see the symbolic importance of Alexandria as sort of a multicultural place, a place where all ideas are accepted, and what happens to Alexandria. So in a parallel way here in The Walking Dead, this Alexandria city will come to his own demise precisely because of the selfishness of all the characters. And I'm going to show you just a clip of this and see if you can realize how this precisely, this idea that we are just selfish, power hungry individuals, that even in the zombie, even in the middle of a zombie apocalypse, we will be more interested in being powerful than in surviving, right? And this idea is clearly seen in season 8, and I'm just gonna play 2 minutes of this clip.
When I first met him, Jesus said my world was gonna get a whole lot bigger. We found that world. We found each other. That bigger world is ours by right. But those who use and take and kill, we end them.
Thank you, Your Majesty. For what? For being such a cool dude.
With everything we've beaten, everything we've endured, everything we've risen above, everything we've become, no matter what comes next, we've won. We've already won!
I've been fighting since the farm. Can't stop now.
We need to win. Let me come with you.
I need to correct you on that point.
We need to keep our faith in each other. If we can hold on to that with everything we have, the future is ours. The world is ours.
Over your ears.
Trust the king.
We pin them and it takes care of itself. That's the plan.
And on this day, we begin to reshape this world. The damned are upon us!
I don't die.
Right, it's about the ability to reshape the world. That's why they fight, to win. There's winners and losers, right? I think you can see how that, underneath that, is precisely that, right? We always will be power hungry. It's impossible that we're not power hungry. Okay, so let's moving on, because I want to finish this lecture with something that it's sort of out of my left field. I'm not an expert in Chinese politics or in Chinese film by any means, but I thought it was really interesting, precisely because, you know, China's rise to power and how China's cinema goes Hollywood in two different ways. And I'll finish briefly speaking about this as how this is not just a Hollywood from the US thing. It's not a particular example that has to do with American politics. The importance of Hollywood has to do with transnational politics. As transnational actors, there are other national cultures that play the same game. You know, and you can see how China rise to power is a threat, as stated in this quote, to the U.S. Congress, right? And how the U.S. Congress were worried with China's influence, and they took China's cultural influence as a matter of national security, right? And this was something that was across the board. Democrats and Republicans agree on that, right? And this is why film is important in the sense that I'm talking about film, not film specifically from different national cultures, but film as a transnational actor, yeah? And then there's that way of China's a threat to Hollywood and pushing out Hollywood. That is one way. But then there is this other way, which is how Chinese stories are constructed in Chinese for Hollywood and are part of the Hollywood system and speak with the Hollywood language, the Hollywood language of universal values from a different place, from a more hybrid place. And it complicates the picture, right? And Ann Lee's Crouching Tower is that example. And in that way, Ann Lee's Crouching Tower was this Eastern film, that Eastern film in the sense of the traditions of the East, right? That was speaking to a Western audience. And to an Eastern audience in the West, i.e. the diaspora, the Chinese-speaking diaspora in the West, right? And not so much to a Chinese audience, right? And this transcultural background is also fits the model of Hollywood universal languages, right? And this is why it's important to consider Hollywood film as an hegemonic consensus-making machine. It's a type of transnational politics. Hollywood, in this case, is a way to look at transnational politics. And Ann Lee, for instance, is successful because he can be, at the same time, an outsider to the Hollywood industry. He was a Taiwanese-born director that was educated in the US that was actually working for work that has worked and keeps working from mainland China as well as from the US, right? It's this hybrid in between director, right? But at the same time, he positions himself vis-a-vis the Hollywood industry as an American hero, as this rags to riches paradigm, right? And Crouching Tiger exemplifies, and I'm quoting here, a good Chinese narrative in global markets, which involves the construction of an ambiguous universality, right? This ambiguous universality that is nor here nor there, but it speaks in the language of Hollywood, that different audiences can attach meanings to authentic Chineseness in their minds, right? So this authentic Chinese, it's almost an empty symbol when it comes to the West. What's important in Crouching Tiger, it's a series of values that you've seen in many other Hollywood films, and that actually will, as I will say in a minute, are foreign within Chinese culture. And it provokes this authentic Chinese, provokes a narrative construction, a challenging task in the middle of divergency in Chinese cultural politics. So all that it means is that this authentic Chineseness in the West creates tensions within Chinese on cultural politics, right? And this tension is created precisely because of the idea of authenticity, because at the bottom of all these languages of values, authenticity and inauthenticity is constructed. And while the Beijing Evening newspaper called Crouching Tiger, quote, a Chinese martial arts film in Western suit that only satisfied Western hand for novelty, Ann Lee knew that he was doing that. He knew that he was creating an Eastern film from Western audiences because he wanted to have in this third place in between. It's a hybridity that turns impure anything that is supposed to be authentic, that questions authenticity. And what this really is, why this is important, is because when authenticity breaks down, you can see the language of universality breaking down as well, right? If authenticity within China is breaking down, that means that type of film is not creating any type of consensus, is not working within a hegemonic paradigm, is going against the grain hegemonic. Now, but when it works in the West precisely because it fits that hegemonic paradigm. Authenticity in the West doesn't break down. And it's not a question of not breaking down because people in the West don't understand Chinese traditions, or don't realize that when you watch Crouching Tiger, there are different accents that don't make sense. If you're in Beijing, you cannot be speaking with a Taiwanese country accent, right? So it's not because of that. It is because the type of values that you can see in Crouching Tiger are much readily accepted in the West, or are not only much readily accepted, are actually designed for the West than for the specific context of China in particular, right? And that's why authenticity here is important. So authenticity is that yardstick, or is that even that window through which we can see if it works, if authenticity works, if something is proven to be authentic, then you can see how behind that there is a hegemonic consensus about this or that values. And I'm not going to play this Last Emperor because I'm pressed for time. But if you click on the Last Emperor, you can see precisely how that Chinese-ness is constructed in such an exotic way, as not basically working, as being completely strange, as not speaking to a Western audience other than in the most explicit Cold War way of thinking about China. It's simply not creating any type of consensus. It's fitting into a consensus already. When something it becomes so exotic, it's so exoticized, what that only means is not that you're creating any type of, you're not creating any type of hegemonic consensus. What is happening here is that you're fitting already with an established consensus. What is important is how, what is more interesting for our purposes is how different films push the boundaries of consensus and create, as well as reflect, different type of hegemonic ideas, these universal values that some Hollywood films speak with, right? So Mulan is another. So this is in this tension. This tension is this global local narrative of films, right? And how you can be, you be by being, by talking of being in between East and West, you can push for a new consensus, right? And that new consensus, in this case, will work in the West mostly, right? And Mulan is that example, right? How it didn't really work in China, but it did absolutely work within the West. This good Chinese narrative, right, in the market. And I'm going to finish with 5 minutes of this lecture, because I think this is another turn of the screw, right? Because we have seen so far how this Chinese cinema is meant to create a new type of consensus in the West, but we haven't seen how new Chinese cinema is creating new consensus within China. And this new consensus also speaks in the language of Hollywood, but it's speaking in the language of Hollywood to Chinese audiences from a Chinese perspective. And here we'll distinguish between patriotism and nationalism.
Furthermore, patriotism doesn't necessarily denote propaganda. It's a characteristic of most, if not all, national action cinemas. In his book, Action Movies, Harvey O'Brien succinctly summarizes the genre as a cinema of striking back, of restoration and reassurance. And in this regard, China's new action films are patriotic in their take on how police forces and military will deal with threats. Still, China's so-called rising nationalism has been widely cited as one of the major factors in the box office success of Wolf Warrior 2, with its release coinciding with the 90th anniversary of the founding of the Chinese People's Liberation Army, implying propaganda components and the widespread adoption of the film as a nationalistic text. Yet, Feelings of nationalism or lack of truly vary from citizen to citizen, young to old, urban to rural, and the spaces in between. In his recent article, Is Chinese Nationalism Rising? For the journal International Security, Alistair Ian Johnson challenges this widely held assumption through various studies conducted in Beijing, and he found levels of nationalism in a state of flux. Summarizing his samples, he states, in four tests for rising nationalism, I find evidence that in some cases, levels of nationalism in Beijing today are lower than they were in the early 2000s. In other cases, the levels of nationalism may be somewhat higher than they were in the early 2000s, but are lower than they were in the mid to late 2000s. Johnson concedes that his sample only refers to Beijing, and that levels of nationalism may vary throughout the country, while also speculating that levels of nationalism peak or rise in spurts following certain occasions, special celebrations, of which the 2015 China Victory Day parade is a good example, with its demonstration of China's latest military hardware, which was showcased in high-definition glory in national television coverage. Shortly after the victory parade, when I agreed to, perhaps I shouldn't have done, I agreed to fill in for a friend who had a scheduling clash, and I went to judge a high school speaking competition out in Henan province. And most of the young participants responded to the potentially individualistic topic of I Have a Dream by instead talking about the recent military parade, professing pride based on how China was realizing its collective dream and had military capabilities that were equivalent to other nations. However, Johnson warns against putting too much academic stock in anecdotal evidence like this, as reports of fiercely nationalistic demonstrations by young citizens, the online attacks of the so-called Little Pink, who go to great measures to defend China in cyberspace, or interviews with university students who wish to adopt a more individualistic ideology, ultimately don't really say much about such a vast and diverse and dispersed country. As such, it's difficult to ascertain to what extent feelings of nationalism translate into box office receipts. But patriotism, if not exactly nationalism, certainly goes some way to explaining the popularity of the new China action film. Perhaps Wu Jing is just riding a patriotic wave with Wolf Warrior 2. In this respect, it has something in common with China's previous box office champ, Stephen Zhao's fantasy The Mermaid, which thrived in part based on widespread concern about China's environmental policies and for a period became an emblematic popular text. Beijing-based film critic Raymond Zhao has attributed the success of Wolf Rory 2 just to a thirst for entertainment. He told The Guardian that Chinese people are exhausted after a day's work. They have a lot of pressure in life. So when they go to the cinema, they say, we don't want a history lesson. We don't want an experience that is similar to sitting in a classroom. We don't want to be educated. We just want to be entertained. At this stage of economic development, it's...
See, we just want to be entertained. Now, this escapism to escape from your everyday life, something that happens in China, but it happens everywhere, is not neutral. And the same way that patriotism, even though is not the same as nationalism, they're not neutral. Patriotism can be entertaining in the same way, that Black Hawk Down is a patriotic movie that is really entertaining, but far from neutral. In this case, it does follow a nationalist agenda, foreign policy agenda, but it doesn't have to. There's plenty of war movies that do not follow that, that could be simply patriotic in the sense that they just have this kind of abstract love for the country, for your imagined community, right? But the fact that they're not, that do not follow explicitly national agenda, i.e. the fact that they cannot be considered nationalist film, that is, it doesn't mean that they're ideologically neutral. It doesn't, in fact, they're much more ideologically effective, precisely because in the language they use, in this case, this new action cinema in China, the language they use is the language of Hollywood to speak not about Hollywood ideas, but about Chinese ideas. It's using a universal language that is explicitly Chinese, that speaks to Chinese audiences, right? And that is why film, in this idea of Hollywood film, in the sense of this universal language that speaks of universal values, is not only political, but it speaks of global politics. And it's extremely important as an example to understand how different transnational actors interact with each other, how transnational politics, and especially the framework of those politics, can be accepted in the global arena, and how a certain common sense about what is acceptable or not acceptable in terms of values and therefore politics, how those are reflected and as well as created from a certain hegemonic consensus, and how that hegemonic consensus can be sometimes pushed and to create new ideas or to even expand those ideas. And sometimes that hegemonic consensus, it simply fit, right? That film simply fit the already hegemonic consensus. It's not doing anything, simply adding more to what it's already known, okay? All right, so these are the questions for the tutorial. Please have a look at them and we'll discuss this in our tutorial time.